So let's go to a couple of the most important stories in John's Gospel. the second Sunday of ordinary time. This function is the inaugural event of John's Gospel. In other words, it's the first, most important kind of story that gets the ball rolling in the public ministry of Jesus. After getting a couple of disciples ready to go, choosing the first disciples as followers, Jesus does this as the first major public event. And so it carries a lot of the same themes that we will find throughout the Gospel according to John. Notice in this story very carefully, it does not name Mary. Come back to that a little later. Why? It does not name Mary. It just says the mother of Jesus was there. The disciples had also been invited. We don't know how many. Sometimes people say, oh, they probably ran out of wine because Jesus was there with all his disciples, right? No, that's a modern false assumption. They think about Mary's ceremony and a reception being just a 2 or 3 hour event after the wedding, right? In ancient times, the wedding reception would have been probably a week-long affair. The family would have been planning for the participation of all the village over 5, 6, 7 days. They should have had tons of wine available as well as other foods and stuff like that. So they didn't just run out of wine because a dozen or fewer extra people showed up in terms of Jesus and his disciples. But the point is here, Jesus says, hey, it's not quite my time yet. Kind of ready to step onto the public stage. But notice what Mary says, not to Jesus, but to the servants. To Mary tells him, kind of, you know, pushing him over that sort of threshold of being a little reluctant. Hey, hey, I'm not quite ready to go public, but she tells the servants, do whatever he tells you, as if he's in charge of the event. It should be the bridegroom and the bridegroom's friends, you know, the hosts of the wedding reception who would have taken care of the problem. Hey, we've got no wine left. But Jesus shows up, and at Mary's instigation, in a sense, Mary gets the ball rolling, he does step forward and do something quite sort of privately almost. It's only the servants who knew what happened with this water jar being filled up. Big, huge stone water jars, provided you know, hundreds of gallons for wine master party to keep on going another few days. And the very end of the story is the most important thing for Joanna Cruz. It says, this, the first of his signs, Jesus did in Cana in Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The whole point of Jesus doing any of the actions that he does in John's Gospel, they're not miracles. They're never called miracles. I mean, to us, they look like miracles, right? Can you turn water into wine? No, I can't, okay? But the point is not that it's the miraculous action of doing things that other people can't do. Is Jesus does something as a sign pointing. You know, think of a stop sign. What's a stop sign? Do you go up to the corner of a street and say, oh, that's a beautiful red octagon. I'm so glad they put up a sign here to beautify the street. No, the sign is not there to be admired for its own sake, is it? The sign is there to get you to do something. If you see a one-way street sign, you're supposed to go that way, not the other way, right? Do you have to? Well, no, not really. You're supposed to, of course, but are you forced to go? It's your decision still. Are you going to follow the sign? Are you going to go that way on one street? Are you going to actually stop at the corner if there's a red object on there, S-T-O-P-I, right? Do you have to? No, it's still your choice. And if you choose not to, what are the consequences? You might get a ticket if there's a cop there, right? You might cause an accident if there's another car coming. You might even kill somebody or kill yourself. Synoptic gospel.